So with this in mind, we took the initiative to organize a conference series, thanks to the funding of a European project called Quantum Internet Alliance, a series of five conferences given by renowned researchers, having both a deep understanding of ongoing efforts, as well as a long-term vision on this topic. So our third speaker is Antoine Brouwers. So Antoine is a CNRS research director at the Institut d'Optique in Palaiseau. He's almost our neighbor. He's at the head of a research group dealing with synthetic quantum matters for exploring quantum many-body physics. As an example of his contribution, Antoine and his team, they build up what is considered as one of the most advanced quantum simulator using optical tweezer, arrays of optical tweezer, trapping each a single atom, and they show that they can control interaction between these atoms by exciting them into read-back states. So Antoine is also the co-founder of a spin-off company commercializing such quantum simulators. He has been granted with several awards, including the Prix Aimé Cotton in 2007, and more recently the CNRS Silver Medal this year exactly. And for all this reason, we are very happy to have Antoine with us today. So don't hesitate to let your question on the chat. I will ask them to Antoine right after his talk. So Antoine, thank you very much for having accepted our invitation. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Nicolas. So you hear me well? That's all right?
We hear you perfectly well. We see you as well, and we see the slides very well.
Good. Perfect. So you want me to put the slide in full screen, or if I can do that?
That's fine. They're all good like this, yes.
Okay. So thank you very much for the invitation, also for putting together this conference. So indeed, what I've been asked to talk about is a bit of a daunting question, actually, which is the status of quantum simulators as of today. And so essentially, what I'm going to talk about is this outline. So first, I will try to recap a bit the general context of these quantum simulations, so in the context of many-body physics, and why we do that. And then I will describe a few platforms. So there is by no means is it going to be exhaustive, because there are many platforms on the market, but I will describe four of them, which are pretty advanced, and you will see in which sense. And finally, depending a bit on the time I have, I will illustrate what this platform have done recently, and I will try to conclude by summarizing exactly the status. All right, so let's start with the general context of quantum simulation. So, I mean, you probably all know that. I mean, the general context is many-body problem in physics, which is this question in physics where you try to understand ensemble of interacting particles. The particles are usually thought of being quantum, and when said this way, essentially, this is very little informative because it covers essentially all physics. So I've placed here a few iconic situations: superfluidity, superconductivity, magnetism, neutron stars. So it goes from condensed matter physics to high energy physics to even astrophysics settings. So of course, we know the equations that we have to solve for this. And the problem is that those equations cannot be solved ab initio because of this exponential scaling of the Hilbert space. If you have d degrees of freedom, then the Hilbert space scales like d to the n. And so the record as of today of an ab initio calculation just for a spin 1/2, which only has 2 degrees of freedom, is about 50. And there is maybe a bit, you can increase a bit the number, but not by much, because each time you add one qubit or one spin, you double the time of a calculation. So, of course, it doesn't mean that because we do not know how to do ab initio calculation, that we don't know anything about the system. And as a matter of fact, over the last 100 years, people have done a lot of predictions about these systems, and we have a pretty good understanding of many of them through usually approximate methods. And so the problem is that those approximate methods, they work usually very well, but sometimes they fail, or sometimes their validity cannot even be very well controlled. And usually this is the case when the interactions dominate in the problem. And this is usually the realm of what people call strongly correlated matter. So the kind of question that people want to ask usually in the context of the situation represented here are, what is the phase diagram, which is to say, what are the ground state properties of the system? What is the out of equilibrium dynamics of the system? Can you characterize phases of matter using entanglement, for example, which is something which is a bit of a new idea from the last 10, 20 years, where you try to import this concept of quantum information onto condensed matter physics, for example. And so, of course, as it's very difficult to tackle this problem directly, and the approximate method can fail, there was this vision put forward by Feynman around in the early 80s, where you could do quantum simulation using synthetic matter. So essentially, you would build a machine, which we now design as a quantum simulator, which is a well-controlled quantum systems, which implements a many-body Hamiltonians that you want to study. This many-body Hamiltonian can be an idealized Hamiltonian or a model Hamiltonian describing a real-life situation, but it can also be a purely mathematical Hamiltonian, something that has been designed just to study particular type of symmetries, particular the role of particular parameters over the system. And so the virtue of this approach is the following. I mean, in principle, if it comes to understanding a real life situation, what a quantum simulator could provide is a larger tunability. So for example, you can vary the geometry of the array, while it's very difficult to do obviously in condensed matter physics, at least over a large range. You could vary some parameters, you can separate the effect. For example, you can see whether impurities are relevant, you can study the role of interactions, just because you can tune all these parameters much more than what you would be able to do on a real system. And second, it's very important to realize that by putting those machines together, we also force people to think about new types of probes and methods. So for example, something which usually is not so easy to do in condensed matter physics, which is to place a CSET out of equilibrium, becomes feasible with those artificial or synthetic systems. So there are actually two ways that have been proposed to perform a quantum simulation. The first one is called the analog method, where essentially the system or the platform that implements the simulator directly implement the model you want to study. So essentially, you have an Hamiltonian model and you realize it directly in the lab. It may be an idealization of a real life situation, but now you exactly implement it in the lab. And therefore, the idea is that if you can start with a system which you know how to prepare, you let it evolve under your machine, and you have the final state that you can probe and hopefully answer your question. The problem with this method, if this is a problem, is that there is a platform for one and a given problem. So essentially, this approach is non-universal. So this is the kind of approach that I will focus a lot on, because this is the one that has produced the most results so far. And usually people have implemented spin models, the Fermi Hubbard, electron or emulating electrons in magnetic fields, for example. So that's the first approach. The second approach is called the digital approach. And the digital approach comes to the idea that essentially, if you got any Hamiltonian, you can synthesize it in a digital way by a set of single and two qubit operation, if the thing can be mapped onto spin systems. So for example, you have this so-called Trotter decomposition, where essentially you break the time evolution of the unitary operator into a set of finite time evolution, which can be described by a set of one or two qubit type of operation. So this is in principle a fully universal approach. The only problem, obviously, is that it requires a full-fledged quantum simulator. But in this way, you can, for example, implement Hamiltonians that are not even physical. Like, for example, this Hamiltonian, which is the product of three spins, which you do not encounter in matter naturally, but you can synthesize by adding those gates that people can perform, at least on the paper, in the lab with a limited fidelity so far. and for example, you can study these three-body interactions. So the system I will focus on mostly today, and I will show you only a few examples of digital simulation at the end, but I will focus on analog approach. So we're the one where essentially your platform implements the Hamiltonian you want to study. So what kind of many-body problems can you simulate? And essentially, I will just give you a very broad map, not at all precise. And you had a talk by Ignacio Sirac yesterday. We'll probably get into more details into this. But it ranges from strongly correlated matters, such as studying HTC superconductivity. You can study transport, the role of disorders, the role of the interactions in the transport, so under some localization, you can understand to a certain extent photosynthesis process. You can understand light scattering, you can understand conductivity in organic polymers, or at least simulate all this. And other place where you naturally find this quantum simulation useful is the study of quantum magnetism, trying to look at antiferromagnetic, quantum phase transition, frustration in triangular arrays. So all these are usually described by spin models. So typically the Heisenberg spin models or the Ising or the XY. So those are just few examples of methods or situations that you can simulate with quantum simulators. And people have thought about other methods, like, for example, the Dirac equation can be emulated, and you can study cosmology, gate theory, quantum chemistry. So there are a lot of promises, although for the moment, they have not been fully realized, it's fair to say. Okay, so the thing which is very important to realize is that in this analog approach, spin models and Hubbard models, which I will come back to later, are kind of the Drosophila of many-body physics. So essentially, as soon as you've got a quantum simulator which implements those models, you have a generic system to study open questions in many-body physics. So it doesn't mean that you need to have a simulator that can simulate any totally arbitrary model. Usually, many of them can be cast in the form of spin models or Hubbard models. All right. So now that we have that, let's try to see what kind of platforms implement that. And so let's dive in a bit more into the technique of what quantum simulators are really in practice. So I will just illustrate this over three different platforms. And this is, again, by no means exhaustive. I've chosen that for a reason that you're going to see in a minute. So there are essentially traditional platforms from AMO physics, so trapped ions, atoms in optical lattices, atoms in optical tweezers, I will describe all of them, but also superconducting circuits that are kind of belonging to this category of what people called artificial atoms. And the reason why I picked up those four ones is because essentially they have already demonstrated useful simulation beyond 50 particles. And 50 particles is important because this is usually beyond this number that you cannot do any classical simulations using usual computers, at least ab initio. And they have the potential of scaling up to a few thousands. I mean, it's more or less depending on the platform, but usually this is what people scale. Second very important approach is that those platforms show some addressability, which is to say that you can manipulate locally and measure locally the spin or at least the properties of the atoms or the particles at each site that you have. And in this way, you can construct local quantities and construct correlation functions that are very important in order to describe many-body systems. And finally, they show a good level of programmability, which is to say that you can control the connectivity, the geometry, the interactions to a large extent. They are not fully universal and you cannot do anything you want, but at least they show some programmability. So let's try to start with the trapped ion quantum simulators, which in a sense is kind of the oldest. And this is a platform which implements naturally spin models. So it starts from a chain of ions usually, and these ions are held in electrostatic traps or microwave traps. Doesn't really matter for the purpose we're going to discuss, but what you see here is a fluorescence image of a chain of 51 ions from the group in Innsbruck. And so each of them can be controlled by lasers. And so, of course, you've got the possibility to encode spins onto internal state of the ions. So I'm not talking about the external motion of the ions, I'm talking about the internal state. For example, you could decide that you pick up two states connected by an optical transition. One will be spin down, the other one spin up. Or you could decide that you work with two states that belong to what is called an hyperfine transition, so close to the ground state. It depends on the ion you choose, and there are practical considerations here, but that those are usually the two states that that you choose. The second thing which is important is that you want to have some kind of interactions between the ions beyond the mere Coulomb interaction, which is therefore free and which is kind of the background interactions. You want to add that. And the way you do that is by adding lasers, and those lasers are state dependent. So essentially, they will apply a force which is different depending on the spin state of the atoms or the ions. So consider here this chain of ions, and we just send two laser beam in such a way that if the two spins point in the same direction, the two ions are going to be moved out of the chain, but by the same amount, and therefore the interactions between them will not move. So essentially, in this case, you do not have any extra interactions beyond the Coulomb interaction. On the contrary, if now one ion is in spin up, the other one is in spin down, what these light force are going to do, they're going to pull one ion in one direction with respect to the chain and the other one to another direction. And as a consequence, the distance between the two ions will have changed, and therefore their Coulomb interactions will have changed. So in this way, you can engineer some force which is spin dependent and which mimics a spin force like an Hamiltonian HXY, for example, which is a flip-flop type of interaction, or an Hamiltonian which is close to the Ising Hamiltonian, where essentially two spins having the same direction will have, so either up or either down, will have energies that are different with respect to up, down, or down, up. And typically, people can engineer couplings that vary as a function of the distance with a power which we can range between typically 1/2 and 2, and 2.5. All right, so that's the first platform. Second platform, ultra-cold atoms in optical lattices. So here again, we will make use of this dipole force, which is the fact that if you've got a gradient in intensity, you create a force. And so you use that, for example, by generating a light which varies in space by, for example, interfering two light fields. Those light fields produce a standing wave. And at each node or antinode, you can trap atoms. Okay, so this is what your trap is. So this is a crystal, if you wish, made out of light. And at the nodes of this crystal of light, you place atoms. You can extend this idea to 3D, and you can even vary the geometry by varying the angles between the beams and essentially having a set of nodes where you can place one and only one atom. Placing one and only one atom is actually difficult, but those are methods that have been designed over the last 20 years. And essentially, you can end up starting from a random distribution of atoms in the array into a fully filled array where you exactly have one and only one atom at each side. And people have done that with various kinds of atoms, bosons, fermions, atoms that have a permanent magnetic moment. People can even now place molecules, actually, ultra-cold molecules there. And so a very important development that arose about 10 years ago was the combination of this optical lattice with the capabilities to measure and locally address the atoms in this array. And the idea is the following. You place a lens, which is essentially an objective with a very large numerical aperture, in such a way that you can resolve each side of the array, so with a resolution which is less than a micrometer, so typically the wavelength of light, which is exactly the distance that you typically have between two sides in an optical lattice. So that was designed in Harvard, but also in Germany. And so this is kind of a typical image that here you can obtain. So this is a fluorescence image with each of the dot corresponds to one atom which is placed randomly in some of these arrays. So for this particular image, not all the sites are filled. And this platform can now handle about 100 atoms routinely, and actually very soon people will reach 1,000. All right, so what does this platform implement in terms of Hamiltonian? So it implements two kinds of Hamiltonians. First, the Hubbard, and then the spin models. So the idea is the following. You've got these arrays, and essentially you've got the combination or the competition between two effects. First, the tunneling across the barrier here, which is described by a tunneling rate, which is T. And you also have the possibility that if the two atoms are placed on the same site, then they have an energy. And this energy can actually be tuned by the experimentalist, for example, using a magnetic field. And so this naturally implements the Fermi-Hubbard models if you are using fermions, or the Bose-Hubbard model if you are using bosonic atoms. So essentially, you've got a term which is called the tunneling, so T, the tunneling amplitude, a C dagger C, which is the creation of a boson, a fermions here on the side, depending on its spin, and then the spins can interact if they have opposite spins. Same way with the Bose-Hubbard model, you've got some A dagger A, which corresponds to the flip-flop between two different sides, and an interaction terms, which depends on the number of pairs that you place in the lattice, in a given lattice site. It turns out that actually that you can also map or transform this model into spin models under some approximations. So when the U energy, the on-site interaction energy, dominates over the tunneling, then you can implement spin models. So essentially, each of the atoms can carry spins, and it implements Heisenberg type of model. And what is interesting is that depending whether you use bosons or fermions, you can either have ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic interaction, which is a second order process T square over U. And so essentially what you do is the exact equivalent in condensed matter physics of the super exchange that you find in, for example, oxide, like a magnesium oxide or copper oxide. All right. Third platform, atoms in arrays of optical tweezers. So this is the platform that we developed at the Institute of Optics over the last 15 years, so to speak. And that started with the pioneering work of Philippe Grandier, where essentially what you have a single laser beam this time, a single laser beam. And in at the focal point of this laser beam, you place one and only one atom. So experimentally, what you need is simply a laser beam which is focused by a lens, on a size which is the smallest as you can, so typically 1 micrometer, and there you place one atom. This atom you can observe because essentially you shine resonant light on it and you monitor, as before in the optical lattices, the fluorescence light on the CCD camera. So now if you want to have many of these little traps, the way you operate is you place in the path which creates the trap a special light modulator which is able to shape the waveform, the wavefront of the light, and in this way, by diffraction, having in the focal planes of the lens the Fourier transform of the phase pattern that you have prepared. So if you have imprinted this phase pattern here, what you'll find is that in the plane here, you will have a set of laser beam, each with a micrometer size, which can be arranged, for example, in this Kagome type of array. And so now you can place one and only one atom in the thing. And so those are examples of fluorescence image, single shot, of atoms that are placed in various structures. So this kind of 1D structure corresponding to about 100 atoms, 2D array, again 2D but in triangular array, so square. You can have even completely arbitrary arrays. So for example, these are fluorescence atoms of atoms that have been placed in a kind of a Mona Lisa type of configuration. So it's totally useful, yes, for physics, but it tells you that we can do these kind of things more or less arbitrarily. And so the thing which is important is that now the number of atoms that can be handled is also in the range of a few hundred. So this is way beyond the capabilities of any ab initio calculations, and even of many of the approximate calculations. All right, so you can even arrange them in three dimensions if you wish, as is represented here. So now we have these arrays of atoms, but very different with respect to the arrays of optical lattices. There, the atoms are too far to be able to tunnel from one side to another. So the distribution of atoms is frozen. And also the atoms cannot interact because they are too far with respect to each other. So the way to make them interact is to promote them to very highly excited states, which are called Rydberg state, so state with large principal quantum number, in such a way that even at large distance, they can have significant interactions. The reason for that being that first, the lifetime of an atom in a Rydberg state is on the order of a few hundred microseconds. So it's not very long, but it's long enough with respect to the interaction energy, as I will show you in a minute. And second, very importantly, classically, these Rydberg atoms correspond to an electron spiraling very far from the nucleus. And as a consequence, it looks like large dipoles. You've got large transition dipole, scaling like the square of the principal quantum number. And therefore, in this way, two atoms separated by even 10 micrometer can have an interaction strength, which is in the range of megahertz. So it means that if you look at the dynamics induced by the interactions, it's a sub-microsecond dynamics. And therefore, you see that it's much faster than the lifetime, and therefore you can operate in a nearly coherent regime. So now, there are different ways for these Rydberg atoms to interact, but in any case, all those ways implement what are called spin models. So the first way would be for the atoms to interact via the van der Waals interaction. So if you place two atoms in the same Rydberg state, they will interact very strongly with an energy which is corresponds to a diagonal shift of the doubly excited state here. And a second type of interaction is what is called the resonant dipole-dipole interaction, where you can have two degenerate situations where two atoms are placed in two different Rydberg states. So here, the mapping onto spin 1/2 is the following one. For this, you would implement what is called the Ising model. So an Hamiltonian of the form the coupling constant C6 over R6 times Ni and J, where Ni and J are the occupation number in the Rydberg state, which is one if the atoms in the Rydberg state and zero otherwise. So the atoms only interact if the two of them are in the Rydberg state. And therefore, the spin encoding is the following one. The ground state of the atoms is down and the Rydberg state is up. In the second type of interactions, what you have is what is called the XY model, where essentially this is a flip-flop type of interaction that you implement, scaling as 1 over R3, and now the spin encoding is done onto two Rydberg states connected by a transition, typically in the microwave region. Okay. Good. The last system I wanted to describe to you briefly is the one which belongs to a totally different world, so not at all the AMO physics world, but rather the artificial atom world. And this is the realm of quantum circuits. And those quantum circuits can implement spin model and Bose bonds. So you will hear a lot about that much more probably tomorrow in the talk of John Martinis. But essentially, the idea here is to use a nonlinear electrical component, which is a Josephson junction. So you would pattern that onto a chip. And so essentially, you can, for example, have this kind of two reservoirs. You've got a loop here through which you can have a magnetic field. So this is one of the many examples of the implementation that you can get. And here you've got two Josephson junctions. And it turned out that if you operate in a regime where what you have is the Coulomb energy associated to the charging of this capacitor with respect to the amplitude to tunnel through the Josephson junction. So when you compare this one, so the tunneling amplitude is much larger than the Coulomb energy. Then you can describe this system by a nonlinear potential, which is actually a sine potential. And so the full Hamiltonian now is the charge Q square over 2C, so kind of the kinetic energy, if you wish, and some kind of potential energy. The thing which is interesting here is that it's a function of the magnetic flux, which you can control, and it therefore has bound state. Those bound state corresponds to number of excitation in the system. And because it's nonlinear, you can select only one transition and therefore encode into spin system. So for example, n equals zero would correspond to spin down, n equal one would correspond to spin up. The typical LC, if you wish, or resonant frequency that people can achieve is in the range of gigahertz. So the problem now that you have and that you do not face with atoms is that you need to eliminate any thermal excitations from the problem so that the circuit looks quantum. And this is done by operating at low temperature. And so typically the temperature, all these are placed in a cryostat at a temperature below 100 millikelvin. All these circuits can be connected to each other by wires or waveguides, and you can have some kind of arrays, a network of these things. And the state of the art as of actually today, so it was announced early this month, was the capability by IBM to handle up to 127 of such circuits. So this is the technology that Google, IBM has adopted. And once again, John Martinis will give more details tomorrow about that. When it comes to the kind of Hamiltonians you can implement, if you just take two of those circuits coupled by a microwave guide, you can implement exactly some kind of model, which are the flip-flop models, so to speak, the XY model, using this kind of encoding. So you've got an up, down, down, up. So the two circuits coupled by the microwave guide. But what you can also do is to use the non-linearity that you have between, so the fact that this transition is not resonant with this one, there is a slight mismatch due to the anharmonicity of the potential, in order to implement a Bose-Brown model. So actually you do a mapping onto a B dagger B, where now B creates excitations in the system. And this anisotropy anharmonicity here translates into some kind of interaction energy, which precisely has the form of a Bose-Brown Hamilton. So this is how you implement this, again, spin model and Bose-Hubbard using those large set of quantum circuits that are all interconnected. All right. So what I will do now, and probably I have something like about 15 minutes, if I'm not mistaken, Nicola. I will try to show you a few examples of quantum simulations that people have done, just to show you that already the system is in a regime where you can do interesting many-body physics with. Essentially, I will try to show you illustration exploring the phase diagram of a complicated many-body Hamiltonian, but also try to show you that you can study out-of-equilibrium dynamics. So I will probably not go through all the illustrations I have because it will be too long, but I will just select a few of them. All right, so let's start with the exploration of the phase diagram. So I remind you that this was one of the open questions that you have, because some of the Hamiltonians, you do not even know what are their phase diagram. And so let me come back to the atoms in arrays of optical lattices, implementing the Fermi-Hubbard model. So you place fermions in them. Each fermion can carry two spins, and this implements this Fermi-Hubbard model. This Fermi-Hubbard model is the simplest model that you can have to describe the interplay between conductivity of interactions. And yet, it's not a problem which is fully solved. There were lots of progress in the recent years, but not the phase diagram is not completely known. So people have come up with some kind of model phase diagram here. You have, as a function of the temperature and the doping, various phases. So for example, antiferromagnetic phases, trench metals, and so on. And so, it's believed that this phase diagram and this Hamiltonian is the one which is at stake to explain high HTC superconductivity. And so in oxide, like high Baikuo type of oxide, which is so high temperature superconductivity. So that's the reason why it's actually critical to kind of explore the phase diagram and see whether the system is superfluid or not. And so we are not there yet, but people have made a lot of progress towards reaching a low enough temperature to explore some of those phases, while before the temperature was too high and you cannot enter the interacting regime. So one experiment I will show you, it's already 4 years old, but it was performed in the group of Markus Greiner in Harvard, was to actually use the quantum gas microscope that I was describing to show that you could enter this range of antiferromagnetic phase. So essentially what you do, and it's a bit subtle experimentally, so I'm not going to give all the details, but you load this optical lattice with atoms having spins. And because you have this ability to measure the spin of each on each of the side, you can see whether when the temperature is low enough, you can have an antiferromagnetic ordering. So this is an example here where the temperature is so high that actually you all the atoms are initially prepared, if you wish, in a given spin state. So they all have the space and spin state. You cool down the system, and what you see is at some point the appearance of a staggered configuration. So here, each of the bright dots corresponds to an atom in spin up. And you see that indeed they have this kind of staggered configuration of magnetization, which you can directly probe. The second important thing is that you can also measure, because you know the spin of each of the atoms, you can form and construct the spin correlations. And as a consequence, you can see what is the range of the antiferromagnetic order in the system. So people can measure the decay of the correlation, and here measure that actually there is a decay over many lattices side, which means that you have an antifermionate with a large correlation length. And so that was the first time that in the context of the Fermi Hubbard, you could enter this antiferromagnetic phase. So already you see that you can probe physics, which has been predicted, but it's still a bit unclear, and you can start to walk through the phase diagram. I will show you a second example, which is the 2D Ising model on a square array. Okay, so it's again a bit related to what we've been discussing with the antiferromagnet. So here you just assume that you've got a square array. Spin down will be the atoms in the ground state, for example. And so now you ask yourself, okay, let's assume that I only have nearest neighbor interaction. And I ask myself, how many excitation can I put in the system? So essentially, as soon as I have one excitation here, I cannot have another excitation nearby because it costs too much energy. So I'm asking myself, how much interaction can I put in the system at zero energy cost? And so what you have is the possibility to get this staggered configuration of having placed an excitation, a spin up. But as you cannot excite a nearby atom, essentially you have all this staggered configuration, which is one example of an AL ordering. You can, of course, have the degenerate one, which is the particle hole conjugate, if you wish. And now, if you place your ensemble in a magnetic field, you can construct the 2D quantumizing model, so in transverse magnetic field, as it's called, which is this Hamiltonian, which has the magnetic field and the spin-spin correlation. And it turns out that this phase diagram in 2D has been explored since the 70s, but people are still working on it. So you can essentially have, as a function of the value of the transverse and longitudinal magnetic field, which are the control parameters, different phases. First, a paramagnetic phase, and second, separated by a quantum phase transition, an antiferromagnetic phase. And the thing which is interesting is that this phase diagram in 2D is only known by numerical calculations. So for example, the tip here of the dome has only been calculated accurately in 2002. So it's not like super old physics, despite the fact it's the canonical example of a quantumizing model in 2D on a square. So this is the simplest situation, and yet people have only calculated the critical point here in 2002. And more importantly, it has never been implemented and measured in 2D, because in real materials, it's only an approximate situation. So now I'm going to change completely language and translate that in terms of Rydberg physics. You remember this Rydberg can implement some Ising model. And essentially, I can implement an Hamiltonian, which looks very much like the quantumizing model I showed you before, where you replace the coupling in front of sigma z by a C6 over R6, the van der Waals interaction, and where now the magnetic field is engineered or implemented through a laser which couples the ground state of the atoms to the Rydberg state, which now is the spin up. So essentially, this term here is the action of the laser, and delta is the detuning of the laser with respect to the transition. And you get an Ising light type of model. So essentially, all the phase diagram I showed you before, so this one, can be changed with different letters, where now B perp is the intensity of the laser, essentially, and the detuning acts like a longitudinal field. So there is this mapping that you can do. So now, if you want to explore the phase diagram, what you're going to do, you're going to start from the paramagnetic phase, which is the easiest to prepare experimentally. Essentially, it means having prepared all the atoms in the down state. And then you will vary slowly the parameters of the Hamiltonian in order to drive the system towards the antiferromagnetic phase. So let's try to do that experimentally. And so we start from a 10 by 10 array, for example, of atoms. So all the atoms are initially separated by 10 micrometer. You apply your laser in order to couple the atoms to the Rydberg state. And then you do a measurement at the end. And what you get as an image is this. So you see that essentially between those two images, what you have is that there is every other atom is missing. And of course, you have to believe me, but it turns out that one missing atom corresponds to a Rydberg atom. So essentially, this is exactly the Nel state that we wanted to have. because it corresponds to an alternance, staggered field where you have up, down, up, down. So it turns out that this was the first implementation of the quantumizing model in 2D. The 2D is very important, it's missing on the slide, because once again, it's only through approximate method, through approximate implementation that people could kind of look at that in real materials. And I should say that there are many other groups that have been looking at that in the recent year, either in 1D or in 2D. The second important thing that we've done in this context was trying to measure the dynamics of the systems when we vary the intensity of the laser. The reason why we do that is because if you vary the intensity of the laser, it's a dynamical problem, and you want to assess whether your quantum simulator is well understood, if you control well enough the error. So you need to benchmark the outcome of the laser, of the simulator. So in order to do that, we've used the order parameter of an antiferromagnet, which corresponds to the difference in the number of spin between the two sublattices that you have in this staggered configuration. And you measure, as a function of time, the growth of the magnetization as you walk through this line. So essentially, you repeat the experiment by stopping at every point in time. And what you see, that starting from the paramagnetic phase, where you've got essentially no correlation, you end up with the largest correlation. And so here, what you have are the lines which would correspond to the situation where we had no imperfections in the system. So at the beginning, it's pretty well, but then it starts to deviate. And at long time, we do observe that there is a discrepancy between the data and the perfect simulation. And in order to understand that, we needed to add the imperfections that are independently measured on the experiment. And so those imperfections, we know them because we can calibrate. We gave them to the theorist, and the theorist can run this curve. And if you average all the possible trajectories over the many imperfections, you do find something which is close to the experimental data. So it's telling you first that the machine is not perfect, but it gives you a roadmap of how to improve the quality of the simulator. And a very important thing is that if for the theorist to implement an approximate method, which is a dynamical method, it's called a matrix product state, for a 10 by 10 square array, one of the curves that you see here, one of these gray, and you need to average in order to have the black curve, corresponds to 14 days of calculation on a cluster computer. So you see that already those machines, because I mean the data can be taken in a few hours, can give you answers in a sense much, much faster than a classical simulation. All right. What I want to show you as a last illustration of this ground state, before I just give you one example of dynamics, is the fact that now you can even engineer with those machines phases of matter that have never been seen. So for example, the group of Michel Lukin in Harvard has recently used this Rydberg platform in order to demonstrate the existence of a spin liquid, and we place them in a variant of a Kagome lattice, which is called a Ruby lattice. So this is not essential, the details. The only important thing that I want to say is that the simulators now are able to explore physics that people have been discussing for many decades now, but which have never been directly observed. All right, I will give you only one example of one out of equilibrium situation, because the time is running, and which is again coming back to what I showed you before in terms of studying the antiferromagnet on a square array. So I told you that essentially you have a quantum phase transition here, and this quantum phase transition corresponds to the closure of a gap. So essentially, the larger the system, the smaller the gaps, and therefore the hardest it is to drive adiabatically the system staying in the ground state. But you can precisely use that by saying that if you sweep too fast, you create defects. And it turned out that there is a scenario, which is what is called a Keeble-Zurek scenario, where if you study the defects, the statistic of the defects that you prepare, then you can extract from that the critical exponent of the line, the critical line here. And so the group of Michel Lukin has done that in 1D and 2D. And essentially, they've been able to measure the critical exponent of the phase transition just by sweeping at various speed across the phase transition. They found essentially the number that you expect from quantum Monte Carlo. But once again, this is the first time that this has directly been measured on any system. So it shows you that those simulators now, if you understand well, are now able to do quantitative predictions that you can compare with the theory. Not with the same error bar, I agree. I mean, quantum Monte Carlo can have many more digits, but still you can clearly confirm those Monte Carlo. All right, so what I'm going to do now, I'm going to skip the few examples that I had before, and I will try to summarize a bit the status of those quantum simulators. And I will try to do that in respect to this kind of holy grail of a quantum computer. So essentially, if you look at quantum simulations and the kind of platforms and quantum computers, essentially the platforms are all the same. People are exploring atoms, ions, superconducting, quantum dots, photons, and many other systems that I have not discussed today. Now, a quantum simulation in terms of analog mode has a limited universality. I was telling you at the beginning that if you have a digital quantum simulator, essentially it's a quantum computer. So on the paper, the universality is limited for quantum simulation in the analog mode, but it's of course universal in terms of quantum computers if you go to the digital mode. Have we reached this quantum advantage? So this quantum advantage is kind of a pretty annoying concept that people come up with and which is spoiling the whole debate about the interest of quantum technology. And essentially, it's telling you, I mean, when does a quantum machine in the lab does better than anything you can do on the classical machines? To put it loosely, because I don't even know what is quantum advantage. I don't really know the definition. Essentially, on scientific questions, quantum simulation have reached the quantum advantage by far. I mean, I showed you simulation of 200 atoms or the phase diagram with a few hundred particles. It's out of questions to calculate that. I've also shown you, and I could have illustrated with our example, that those machines have actually led to real discoveries that were not anticipated because people couldn't do calculation in this regime. Now, when it comes to the quantum computer part of the digital mode, if you wish, the quantum advantage, I don't know. I mean, people were having claimed that you may have seen quantum advantage for random circuits. That was the announcement of Google a year ago. Now, I'm not sure what is the status of that any longer because people have said, no, but you can do that on a laptop as well. So I don't really know. But in any case, on any real world situation or scientific question, this digital approach has not reached the quantum advantage. What kind of model can you solve? With a quantum simulator, you can solve fermions and bosons as well as spin models. And you can essentially map one onto other and so explore a wide range of models, which, as I was telling you at the beginning, are kind of the Drosophila of many body physics, and therefore, in principle, are generic of many systems, many situations. Now, if you have a quantum computer, it's in principle universal, and you can solve any problems that can be mapped onto what is called the gate model with qubits. The system size. As of today, you can operate in the lab almost daily from 50 to almost 200. So we've done in our lab, the largest was 200, it's the same in the group of Misha Lukin. While for quantum computing, so far it's about 50, even if people are now having platforms around 100. And the thing which is interesting is that for the quantum simulation, in principle, there is a direct path towards thousands or a few thousands within a few years. And we're not talking about decades. In the case of quantum computing, I'm not quite sure. The large number you hear are in the few hundreds. But in any case, if you want to implement quantum error corrections, you would need many, many, many more of those ones. All right, but so it doesn't mean that quantum simulation is already winning on all sides, because if you want your quantum simulator to be able to make quantitative predictions, there is a key challenge that we all need to tackle. It's how do you validate, how do you certify the output of the simulators when you have no way, no other approximate method to compare it to? So you can compare the outcome of different platforms with different different implementations and see whether they converge. All right. So as a conclusion, the thing I wanted to show you is that essentially useful quantum simulators already exist. Of course, they only tackle so far scientific problems, so a bit academic type of problems, and they challenge theory. That's the important thing. Second thing is that it's a very active field internationally, that I'm pretty sure you are convinced about that. And so that, just to name one example, there is a large EU network that tackles this, coordinating many groups and also industrial partners. And people have created companies, and companies are as large as Google or IBM, for example, to develop industry-grade simulators. And the applications are already envisioned, so scientific computing, optimization, as you find in many instances. And if you allow me just 1 minute, Nicolas, I just want to tell you one thing, which is that those quantum simulators, sure, they can look at scientific questions. But you should think of them more generally as machines which prepare useful quantum states. And those states are not necessarily of interest in the context of many-body physics, but they can be of interest for optimization problems. So for example, many optimization problems that we encounter in daily life, like, you know, Amazon delivering delivering parcels all over the planet, and you need to minimize the distances between one place to another hub, can be quite often mapped onto the Ising model. So you need to minimize the cost function, and this cost function is usually exactly the Hamiltonian of the Ising model. So by finding the ground state for various connectivity, you can, in principle, find the solution of your optimization problems. Second thing that they know how to do, they prepare a state with a high amount of entanglement, even if it's very hard to characterize. And this could be useful in metrology, because the stake of metrology is to improve the ultimate resolution, which is given by the standard quantum limit, to what is called the Heisenberg quantum limit. And so you can do that if you use entangled state that are prepared by those quantum simulators. And finally, and this is long-term, and I don't know whether it's going to be completely, whether we'll ever be able to reach that, but I mean, people are working hard toward that, is of course, they will be able to get transformed into quantum computers. All right, so with that, I thank you very much for your attention, and sorry for having been a bit over time. So.
Thank you very much, Antoine. I think we could not have hope for a better review regarding the status of quantum simulation. So thanks a lot for this. So we have several questions in the chat. So I won't use any filter, just read them. The first one is from someone called Silberman. So when you say that you are able to solve fermion, boson, and spin model with quantum simulator, do you mean that you could find the minimum eigenvalue and eigenstate of the Hamiltonian?
In principle, yes. Of course, you have to be careful. The systems have imperfections, and therefore, this is an approximate eigen energy, an approximate eigen state. The eigenstate, you can read it out directly. I mean, I showed you the example of the antiferromagnet. So, I mean, in this case, it's a bit trivial because the eigenstate is just up, down. So it's a classical eigenstate. But indeed, you can measure the energy, and you can measure directly, just visually, you look at what is the wave function. So in principle, the answer is yes to this question. Modulo, once again, all the errors, and the big question is that when you have something that you read out, is it really the ground state of the system? That's the whole point. But so people can kind of calibrate the machine and hopefully be able to decide that it's a good approximate ground state.
Yeah, maybe a follow-up question about the errors, Antoine. So, you know, you were saying at the beginning of your talk that, well, we can tackle in theory many physics problems, but most of the time we rely on approximation. This is something that you can hopefully go beyond and experiment. But in this case, you have imperfection. So how do you plan to deal with imperfection to go beyond what we can do in theory given that, you know, the technique that you have shown before, meaning a proper characterization of the problem, including errors, might not be able, you know, once you go to large scale problems where it would not be possible, for example, to simulate anymore the system and then to include this error and to see if indeed you're properly solving the problem.
Okay.
Can you comment on this error? And
yes. So your question is the $100 billion question, of course. That's the whole challenge of the whole field, is trying to assess the answer that the simulator gives you, because the simulator always gives you an answer, so there is no problem. The problem is that is it the answer to the question you're asking. So you have to see here that quantum simulation from this respect is very different from quantum computing, because in quantum computing the whole stake is that performing the calculation can be extremely difficult and the computer does it for you, but as soon as you have an answer you can check that this is the right answer. Here, because of the nature of the question that you're asking in quantum simulation, it's much more difficult. So there are different ways. First, you can ask yourself qualitative questions, which is, does the Fermi-Hubbard ground state in whatever regime sustain superconductivity, for example? You could measure something, an observable, related to superconductivity. And even though your state is imperfect, you can see whether or not you have superconductivity or traces of superconductivity. So it's kind of a qualitative answer that you could ask. When it comes to quantitative answer, the whole deal is trying to calibrate how the error propagates when you grow the sign of the system. So you need to do some kind of finite size scaling, if you wish, the same way you do with a classical computer, I guess, in numerical simulations, and trying to make sure that the errors do not explode exponentially with the number of qubits. Because if they do, I mean, of course, the whole thing is doomed. So there is this whole effort of trying to calibrate the errors, of course, minimize them, and trying to see their scale. And that you can already do by comparing two situations where you have the calculations available. Now, of course, you have to assume that you can extrapolate, but the same way you have this problem in classical simulations. So those are essentially the two ways. And there is a third one, which is people are designing methods to self-calibrate the simulator. So essentially, I mean, think about atomic clocks. Atomic clocks are clocks that are supposed to be extremely precise, but how do you decide that they give the right time? The only way that people have to check that is you build different clocks with different technologies, for example, and you beat them together and you see whether they drift with respect to each other. Okay, so that's already a first indication that they give the right time, if you wish. So here, one approach could be to have various platforms, and people have already started to do that, actually, using widely different technologies, like, for example, superconductor and ions. You ask the same question if you can, because the point is that most of the time they work in complementary regime, but if you can, you ask the same question and you compare the answers to your simulation. So this is another way to kind of assess the quality of your answer. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, very well, thanks a lot. So there's another question in the chat from Colin. So you mentioned quantum simulation had been used to simulate photosynthesis. So could you elaborate on this study? How many qubits were used and what kind of simulator?
So that's a good question. So if I convey this idea that we're using quantum simulator to understand photosynthesis, I fail, because we have not done any useful simulation of photosynthesis so far.
Right.
I was just mentioning the fact that transport can be thought in contexts that are different from the traditional one of, you know, transport in metals or something like that. And indeed, if you want to model photosynthesis, you can use, for example, spin Hamiltonians. I have not at all said that at the moment I have a clear way of testing why there is a high transport efficiency. I mean, this is a question that people are looking at, but there is no clear answer to this. So for the moment, the quantum simulation approach has not shed any light on this particular process.
Thank you again. There is another question by Ben Panjo. You provided a comparison between what a quantum simulation or the actual quantum simulator can do with respect to actual quantum computers. But can you say a bit more about the advantages and drawbacks of each experimental approaches related to quantum simulation?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So, but it's not a very easy one. So, for example, there is something that the atoms do well. And the thing that they do well is that at the moment, they are reasonably easy to scale up in terms of numbers. So I showed you the optical lattice. I showed you this array of tweezers. At the moment, it's a few hundred. It will be within the next year, essentially, a few thousand at least. But for example, if you want to simulate Fermi models, Fermi-Hubbard model, the atoms are kind of the only one that you can use natively, because, I mean, atoms can be either fermions or bosons. So you immediately have the statistics. The quantum circuits and the ions, and to a certain extent also the Rydberg, they can only implement spin models. So you see that in terms of the type of model you can implement, it's not the same depending on the platforms. Of course, you can map one onto another one, but usually this is the price of an overhead in terms of the number of qubits. So that would be one advantage. If you are interested in spin models, you can take Rydberg, quantum circuits, or ions. If you are interested in fermions, you could take atoms in optical lattices. The second advantage, I would say, the other difference is in terms of the numbers that are handled at the moment. Neutral atoms handle more particles than the ions and the superconducting circuit so far. But the superconducting circuit and the ions at the moment have the huge advantage of a high fidelity, a very large fidelity of all the operations. So in a sense, they are the only ones that have demonstrated a quantum simulation in the digital mode. Those were just proof of principle experiments, so the problems could have been solved on the laptop at the moment, but it's not the point. The point is that they are already in a regime where the fidelities are becoming high enough that you can envision a digital quantum simulation. At the moment, it's much harder to do with the neutral atom platforms. So this, I would say, are the three things. So fidelities, the plus are in the spin and the circuit. The numbers, the plus are in the neutral atoms, at least today. And if you are interested in native fermionic system, it's probably better to use atoms in optical lattices. So, I mean, I hope I answered the question more or less in a satisfactory way. It's,
At least for me, that was perfect. There's a question about entanglement by Steele Zilberman. So are particles in quantum simulator entangled in the same way the qubits are entangled in quantum computers? So I'm not sure exactly how to understand the question.
I would say yes. If you think of your quantum simulator as simulating spin models, essentially, it's exactly the same as having a set of qubits. And therefore, the type of entanglement for me is probably the same as in a quantum computer. So I would say that yes, the entanglement is the same. Now, when it comes to the entanglement in the Fermi-Hubbard model, the statistics comes in, but it's again some kind of. Then I would say it's probably a bit different. But I mean, as long as you are thinking about spin models, I would say it's the same between simulator and computer, because we're always dealing with essentially two-level systems, at least for now.
All right. So. If you still have time, Antoine, there's maybe a last question from Pietro Torta. Is it possible to define a set of models to benchmark quantum simulator such that their solution is hard but known, similarly to NP problems with an already known solution?
So I need to read the question again. Is it possible to define a set of models benchmark quantum such that their solution is hard? Well, I mean, on the paper, yes, it's just that no one has really done it. So the kind of thing that people are looking at the moment, and it's a bit related to questions that I've seen above from Zilberman about the Kubo problem. It turns out that finding the minimum independent set of, on a graph problem, which is one example of cubo problem. I'm starting to talk about things I don't really understand yet, but okay. At least this is my understanding. Some of them are NP hard, but you can find heuristic that gives you a good solution. And so essentially, you could try to benchmark your simulators on this kind of graph problem. So that would be an example where you could design a model and compare an NP hard problem to a heuristic solution. I'm not sure I'm given a fully satisfactory answer because I'm not completely sure I fully understood the question, but
I hope so. Maybe as a last very general question, this is the typical question that we ask in previous talks, Antoine. So once you succeed to get a large scale, fully flexible quantum simulator, what would be your favorite physics problem that you'd like to tackle on it?
I don't know, because there are probably the ones I don't know yet. The kind of problem that honestly, I would be interesting, but it's beyond even condensed matter physics. I mean, I would be able to characterize experimentally entanglement in this system. So it's a problem which indeed has to do with the programmability of the system, but at the moment is just trying to find criteria to define the complexity of an entangled state, which at the moment we don't have. So it's both an experimental and a conceptual problem. But the thing that I've seen, which I found pretty amazing over the last 5 to 6 years, is the number of concepts and methods and procedure that people are coming up to describe complexity in a much more formal way. So that would be the kind of problem I would be very interesting in looking at.
Interesting.
As of today, it may change tomorrow, but
thank you very much, Antoine. So again, thanks a lot for having accepted our invitation. It was a very instructive talk, a very nice review about the status of quantum simulators. So thanks a lot, Antoine.
Thank you.
I can just add that if people are interested, there's another talk tonight at 6 p.m., a talk from Professor Svorth from Microsoft, and she will present us the status of quantum algorithm. Thanks a lot, Antoine.